Welcome to the Sermon Podcast of Treasure House, a branch of Christ Way Ministries International. We are a family of joyful believers on a mission to change the world with the gospel of Jesus through soul winning and soul building. We believe that these teachings will enrich your soul and strengthen your love for God. Be blessed as you listen.
This morning, glory to God. Hallelujah. We have in the house this morning our own apostle. Glory to God. Our father, our mentor, our teacher this morning. The one who has always been praying for us, shepherding us, teaching us, training us, praying for us, counseling us. Can we celebrate Pastor in the house this morning? Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Celebrate our assistant pastors. Celebrate all the ministers. Celebrate the HOF, the council members. Glory to God. Let me celebrate my dear friend here, Pastor Tolu. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Please have your seat this morning. Hallelujah. Can we celebrate the music ministry this morning? You will help me with that song before we go into God's word. Lord, I serve you. Lord, I serve you. Lord, I serve you. Forever, forever,
serve you.
Lord, I serve you.
Oh, Lord, I serve you.
Lord, I serve you.
Lord, I serve you.
Lord, I serve you.
Forever.
One more time. This morning, we pray that you grant unto us great understanding. For in Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. And the whole church will shout a louder Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. This morning we want to consider the topic assessing, okay, the blessings of God. Hallelujah. Assessing what? The blessings of God. In place of that blessing, you can also put the word resources. Glory to God. Let me explain it to you this way, that the blessings of God are tangible. In other words, when you talk about blessing, they are not just, you know, a lot of the time we quote Ephesians chapter 1 verse 3, all right, and we assume that these blessings are just things manifest in the spirit. Glory to God. But there is tangibility to them. Tell your neighbor, say there is tangibility to the blessings of the Lord. You are not telling your neighbors, you are telling me. Tell your neighbors, look to their eyes, look at them and tell them. Say there is tangibility to the blessings of God. And I'm glad to announce to you today that I've come to give you those tangible blessings.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
Somebody lift up your hand and say, I'm receiving blessings today.
I'm receiving blessings today.
Whatever blessings you want to receive, Lord, we receive your blessings today. Said, for bodily exercise profited little, but godliness is profitable unto all things, having promise of the life that now is, and that which is to come. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation. For therefore we both labor and do what? Suffer reproach, because we trust in the living God. Somebody say, I trust in the living God. Who is the Savior of all men, especially of those that believe? These things command and teach. Let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, in purity. Till I come, give attendance to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. Neglect not the gift that is in thee, which was given thee. Hallelujah. Gifts were given. which was given thee by prophecy, with the laying on of the hands of the papistry, or the elders. He said, meditate upon these things. Give thyself wholly to them, that thy profiting may appear to all. The last verse. He said, take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this, what will happen? Thou shalt save thyself and them that hear thee. You know, it told us in earlier verses that this should be done during our conversations. In other words, when you find your friend and you're likely to talk to them about the class that you just had or the class you're about to have, he said, from that simple and probably common and general conversation, he said, what you should discuss with them are the things that you have received of the word of God. Hallelujah. Let's check another scripture before I go deeply into the teaching. Let's go to Psalm chapter 34. We'll take from verse 1 to 10. Hallelujah. I'll bless the Lord at all times. Somebody say, I'll bless the Lord. At all times. No matter what it is you are going through, do what? Bless the Lord. Keep your eyes on Him and just bless Him. Just bless Him. Lord, I thank you. Lord, I thank you. Be full of thanksgiving at all times. He said, His praise shall continually be in my mouth. You know, it reminds me of a song that Pastor Prince would usually sing. Let us exalt the name together. He said, my soul shall make our boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. He said, oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord. Somebody say, I sought the Lord. How many of you have come to church today to seek the Lord? I sought the Lord. What did he do? What did he do? He heard me and delivered me from what? Next verse said, they looked unto him and were lighted, and their faces were not ashamed. There was a difference immediately about them. He said, this poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. He said, the angel of the Lord encamped round about them that fear him, and does what? And delivered them. He said, oh, taste, and do what? And see. You see, when we tell you that there is experience, full experience of God's word, he said, thanks God's word. Thanks God's word. Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word. He is telling you that you literally can eat God's word. You know, Ezekiel's account of the scripture is one of the most graphic ones that you can. And it talks about that man appearing to him, telling him to eat of God's word. Hallelujah. He said, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man. Sorry, go to 8. We've seen 8. Thank you. Blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord, that trusted in God with all his heart. Verse 9, he said, oh, fear the Lord, ye saints, for there is no want to them that fear him. Verse 10, where we are ending. Can we take it together? Want to go? The young lions do lack and suffer hunger, but they that seek the Lord. Hallelujah. How many of you believe that scripture? Let's take it one more time together. And I want you to do it with vibration in your voice. One to go. The young lions do lack and suffer hunger, but they that seek the Lord shall not want any good thing. Hallelujah. You know, if you study the pattern of the blessings that God shares in the Bible, as early as Genesis, or if you want to go specifically to when everything was almost listed out in Deuteronomy, you will summarize them into the following, either the blessings or the curse. You will summarize them into the death, into sickness or illness or disease and the likes. You will summarize them into poverty or into shame. 4 things. I'll take it one more time. If you see a curse in the Bible, all right, you see a blessing in the Bible, it's either addressing or it means that the person is going to die, literally. Glory to God. Remember that from Adam, right? It also means that the person is going to be in sickness or infirmity or diseases or illnesses. Glory to God. It could also mean that the person is going to be in poverty. In other words, they are going to experience perpetual lack of resources. Glory to God. Glory to God. Not just money, resources. Hallelujah. There are going to be perpetual lack of people. There are going to be perpetual lack of properties. Hallelujah. And the last one is shame. Somebody say shame. You know, when people say things like, I want to do something on time, the question is, why on time? And a lot of the time, they would also mention that they want to do it because they feel it's their time, quote unquote. Why is it their time? Usually because there is a, should I call it a time stamp or something like that, that they measure themselves by. And once they see themselves falling short of that time, all right, especially when my classmates in school, they are like this, the people that will grow up together, they are like this and all of that, it begins to create some level of being unable to associate with those people. That is the shame. Hallelujah. But you see, all of this, Jesus came and took on. He came to take the debt. He came to take the disease. He came to take what? The shame and what? And the poverty. And you see, these are the resources that have been provided for you. The opposite, all right? That have been provided for you so that you can serve the Lord. Hallelujah. So you tell someone to come to the front of the church to come and speak. They tell you that what? They are shy. Have you had such comments before? They tell you that they don't know what to say. Glory to God. They tell you what else? They tell you they don't know how to go about it, that they are new to it and all of that. But you see, one thing that they are doing and they are probably not aware of is that they are magnifying what is not theirs. Hallelujah. You see, when the Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, about the new creature, it was not joking. The Bible was not just making a reference. Hallelujah. There is actually a newness about you. There is actually access to resources that you have received. Hallelujah. And because you have those assets, you can function in service to God perpetually without blinking an eye or doubting or anything. Hallelujah. So when Mama came up today, she showed you clearly how to go about that worship called coming together as believers. So when you ask people, why are you not coming to church? They come up with excuses like, oh, I don't have transport. I was at work. All the things that Mama was saying. Do you understand? Why are they giving that or those excuses? It's because they are recognizing the lack instead of the abundance provided for them by God. Hallelujah. But the Bible told us, where we read earlier, it said, even if the young lion, do you know what it means for the young lion to lack? How many of you know the relationship between a chick and a hen, mother hen? Glory to God. Is it very easy to go and pluck the chick from the mother hen? Think of the king of the jungle. Hallelujah. Do what? Apply the same to the king of the jungle and see what it does to the enemies of the children. And the Bible tells you that even if that child, that kid, can lack for any reason, it said you will not. Hallelujah. He said, they that seek the Lord shall what? Shall not want any good thing. You know, there is this popular scripture that we would often quote, and sometimes we take it as confession, but not exactly. That's Psalm 23, verse 1. What is it, Psalm 23, verse 1? So what is it, Psalm 23, verse 1? Can we echo it one more time? The second part, what does it say? I shall not want. You know, to take that as a confession is to go about saying that I'm a man, I'm not a woman. Hallelujah. It's the truth. Let me explain to you. What that scripture is saying is that if you follow the leadership of the shepherd, you will not want. Hallelujah. It's not so much a confession that because you are acknowledging the Lord as a shepherd and then he will start supplying, but because you are perpetually, you know what the Bible says in Acts, in the book of Acts, I think chapter 7, about Joseph. It said the Lord gave Joseph wisdom and favor before Pharaoh. That is what it means to have the Lord as a shepherd. That he continually, consistently supplies you with the wisdom, with the favor, with the honor to get things done. Somebody say, service is beautiful. You know, we have four S's: salvation, sanctification, service, and success. Many people have that fear of, maybe success will not come. Maybe I will fail. Maybe I will get to the front of the stage and I will start saying what I don't know. Glory to God. And maybe I will start stuttering and all of that. You see, that fear is not from God. That the same way, that thought of, you know, today's service, I don't feel like going. It can never be from God. Should I take it one more time? That thought of let me read my Bible can never be from the devil. Hallelujah. Would the devil actually carry the Bible to do what? To pray? No, 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 no. Hallelujah. Let's go to Romans chapter 8. Let's go to Romans chapter 8. Let's start from verse 13. I want to see something about being sons of God and the supply available for us. He said, if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. That's very simple, right? If you do what? Live after the flesh. What will happen? In other words, you have left the position. You remember the four things that we said earlier? You have left the position or the acknowledgement of the blessings and you are in the opposite. He said, once you start doing that, so you are considering, like Mama was saying, so you have this feeling of, I don't feel like going to church today. That feeling is you walking in the flesh. Hallelujah. Actually, if you go to verse 1, let's quickly go to verse 1, and then we'll come back to verse 13. There is therefore now no condemnation to what? To them which are in Christ Jesus. So your own is probably not even the feeling of tiredness. Yours is that I did certain things, certain time, and therefore I am not worthy to serve. Hallelujah. What does the Bible say about that? Can we take it together? Want to go? There is therefore now no condemnation. Put your book divider in Romans chapter 8. Let's go to Jude chapter 1 quickly. Jude chapter 1. Father, we give you thanks. Oh, hallelujah. Rana mande kele baratash. I believe, I receive, I partake. I receive, I believe, I partake. Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ, and brother of James. Identity. This is the same person who came from the same place Jesus came from. Literally. Biologically. Hallelujah. But what is the first thing that he says about himself? The servant of Jesus Christ. Why can he acknowledge himself as a servant? He will tell us now. He said to them that are what? Sanctified by God. Them that are made special. Them that are clean, them that have been renewed and redeemed. Sanctified. Do you believe in that you have been sanctified? That you are not known by your sins again. That God has the power to deliver. If that is what you want, if you are not recognizing right now that you have been delivered, that God has the power to bring you off of that. Hallelujah. He said that sanctified. If you remember what we read earlier in Psalms, even in Psalms, the Bible recognized saints. Think about that. These people have to go yearly, meaning that they are not cleansed until the first day of the year. And still they believe that they are saints. Or probably David believes that he's a saint. Glory to God. Yeah, the Bible tells us you have been sanctified by God. Hallelujah. So you need this acknowledgement. You need this acknowledgement that you are not so different from Jesus. In fact, you are not different at all from Jesus. That blood that was in him is right there inside you, has atoned for you. Hallelujah. He says, sanctified by God and preserved in Jesus Christ. You know what Paul said? He said, God is able to keep you until the day of the Lord. Your ministry is not going to work. What do you mean? He's going to keep you. He's going to preserve you. Do you know the reason why you have not gone to heaven the day you got saved? It's for this calling. And who is going to keep you for that? He said, God is going to do that. Somebody say, God is going to do that. You cannot so much preserve yourself. You cannot so much. Not even a tiny bit of preservation can you do for yourself. God is the one who preserves our lot. He's the one who perpetually orders our step. That is why we talked about the Lord is our shepherd. So I'm a sheep to God. Hallelujah. He directs me. I have no argument about it. Whatever it says, to serve, I'm there. Hallelujah. He preserves you. What did he preserve you for? And called. Somebody say, I'm called. Somebody is not personal. I say, I am called.
I am called.
Tell your neighbor, say, I am called.
I am called.
So the resources that you need for this calling, how do you go about them? Now let's go back to Romans chapter 8. And let's continue from that verse 13. That you are not functioning in the consciousness of your flesh again, or that there is a lack around you, but instead you are sure and you are aware that God has made preservation, has done a preservative mechanism. Glory to God. How many of you know that when you take cake sometimes, you take a tiny bit of alcohol sometimes? Glory to God. Hallelujah. But why is it in there? It's in there to preserve the pastries or whatever. Glory to God. That is the same way. When you go around, you might not be aware, but I'm calling your attention to it right now. That there is the Spirit of God on your inside. And that is the supply of all things. He said, for if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, what will happen to you? Your ministry will thrive. Your business will thrive. That family you are bothering about will thrive. How are you sure of that? Because there is the preserver on your inside. The Spirit of the Lord reveals who I am. Verse 14. The Spirit of the Lord reveals who I am. For as many as are what? Led by the Spirit of God. They are the sons of God. Do you know every instance when the Bible refers to Jesus, this was the same word son that was used for him? You are thinking you need to be led to be son. The Bible is saying you are son already and you are led. So it's not the Lord is your shepherd so that will come and lead you. You are led where you are right now. You are listening to the voice of God. You will not, if you are not in this service right now, you pick the tape later. I'm telling you, the voice that told you to pick this tape later is the voice of God, not the voice of the devil. You are led. You have received the instruction of God. You have the character of God on your inside. You are not just receiving, you have it already. Hallelujah. The word of God is inside of me. You know what Peter said? He said, we are born again, not of the corruptible, but of the incorruptible, which is the word of God that liveth and abide forever. In other words, what God is speaking to you is not something coming from outside. You're thinking from within. You are what? You're hearing it. Hallelujah. This word is available for you. Preach it to your neighbor. Say, this word is available for you. You're not looking for the word. You're not far from the word. God's word is with you all the time. God's word is with you all the time. Tell your neighbor one more time. Say, God's word is with me all the time. There is no day that you don't have God's word. There's no day. You're not an unbeliever looking for the word. Do you know one amazing thing that the Bible tells us in Acts chapter 10 about Cornelius? This man was praying. It's not so much about being God-fearing. You know, a lot of the time we ask ladies who do you want to marry, and they tell you, I want a God-fearing man, things like that. Glory to God. And I'm saying this, perhaps your own need or the reason why you're not serving God yet is because you want to get married on time. Hallelujah. And you're trusting God for this. The want to bring the man, to bring the woman, is right there on your inside. Of Cornelius, the Bible will tell us that he was pious, he was this, he was that, he was praying, he was giving alms. But he lacked what you have, salvation. The power of God unto sozo, unto all deliverance, unto health, conviction, and power. Hallelujah. Somebody say, God is on my inside. Let's go back to Romans. Let's exhaust Romans before we move on. Man de Kapaladosh. For as many as are led, say they are the sons. 15 says, for ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear. There's no fear for you. You are not wasting your time in church. Oh, maybe if I spend too much time in church, maybe I will not do well in my academics. No. You see, this foundation called God's word is where we build everything. Is where we build our family. Is where we build our business. Is where we build our career. Is where we build our future. Is the resources that we have. Glory to God. He said, we have not been given that spirit of bondage again to fear. He said, but we have received what? The spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. So do you have a need, a lack? Don't focus on it. Focus on your Abba. Focus on your Papa. Focus on Him who has inexhaustible wealth. Focus on Him who has all ability. You know what John the Baptist said? He said, you are looking to Abraham, your father. He said, no. You see, God can make stones to rise up to be sons unto Abraham. What does that mean? God has power for anything and everything. Anything and everything. Hallelujah. Whatever it is, God has the power for it. And what I'm now making you understand is that power, God put them on your inside. He said, the spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. So there is a recognition, acknowledgement on your inside that you belong to God. Next verse. He said, and if children, then heirs. You might not understand that. To call you the heir of God, you might not understand that. In certain terms, you say it's blind to us. So, heirs, okay, maybe when God dies, we inherit it. At least that's the idea of heirs that we have. But it's not. Someone, tell your neighbor, say it's not. Say, right now you have everything. It's not something you are trying to manifest. You know, we use that a lot. Assuming that, oh, after you have done a lot of prayers, after you have done a lot of this and that, and then you step into it. No. You are heirs right now. Hallelujah. You are heirs when? Right now. Hallelujah. He said, heirs of God. He said, and joint heirs with Christ. So probably you don't have an idea what the heirs look like. Probably you are looking to angels to try to draw out what it looks. He said, no. You are joint heirs. With who? With Christ. Not Jesus. With Christ. With the Christos himself. Joint heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, that we what? May be also glorified together. So let me add this to the template of how you go about these resources that have been provided to you by God. That you suffer with God. Your house is not so far that you cannot come to church. That you will start giving excuses of transport fare. You know, Pastor will share with us a lot of the time how in the early days he would give out his all entirely, materially. Hallelujah. You know, there was a time, I think about last year, we had Ekodomio, and I think the Ekodomio was supposed to start about maybe 7 or there, but I was in church by 6. I will not say more than that. Hallelujah. If you understand, if you don't understand, when you get home, you'll get it. Hallelujah. It's the consciousness that we hold that no matter what it is that we are going on right now, the priority is to serve God. That we are sold out to him. That we don't have a life outside him. We don't. We don't. There is nowhere under heaven that we can run to. We don't. And that is our conviction to serve him at all times. Hallelujah. Let's go to 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 10. We'll take it to 13. I want to show you something about those who probably have this high esteem for their work, and that is the reason why they don't serve. There's nothing bad about it. Work. Tell your neighbor, say work. Tell them one more time, say work. But let's see what the Bible says about the work. You know, there are about 2 or 3 scriptures here, or passages here, that are quite familiar. But we pick them out of context, and that's why we are taking it from 10 to 13, so that we can have a robust view of what God will have us understand from here. He said, for even when we were with you, this we commanded you, that if any would not work, what should happen? Neither should he. You know, this context that we are checking right now, the Bible also recorded in Ephesians, St. Paul recorded to the Ephesian church in Ephesians chapter 4, verse, probably if time, if time permits, we'll check that also, 28. He said, let him that stole, do what? Steal no more, but have to do what? To eat? To eat? Church, is it to eat? No, to give. This man just finished stealing. Maybe the person is in poverty, right? He should have to do what? Eat. He said to have to do what? You would assume, go back to verse 10, please. You will assume that this is the end of the thought, that everybody that is working should work to do what? And it's even a noble thing. The Bible tells us that any man that will not provide for his family is what? Is worse than an infidel. It's noble. Glory to God. But let's continue. Verse 11 now. For we hear that there are some which walk among you what? Disorderly. In earlier verses 9 there about all the other verses was talking about these busybodies. He said, walking not at all, but are going about talking. If you check 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7, it talks about old wives, fables, all those different kind of people in the church. That's the people that is telling them. Verse 12 now says, now them that are such, we command and exhort by what? Our Lord Jesus Christ, that with quietness they walk and eat their own bread. Which confirms also the scripture that says, God gives bread to what? The eater. And he gives what? Seed to who? To the sower. Many people stop in 12. Let's see what 13 says. So if you think your labor is only just to have and eat, it's not. He said, but ye brethren, do what? So if he was talking about finances, what we're doing is he talking about here? Hallelujah. In other words, don't be like busybodies. Be the mature ones giving to others. Be the one who recognizes the ultimate power, the ultimate power of God on your inside, that you can communicate it to somebody else. So if you give excuses like, I cannot teach God's word because I don't know what to say, it's because you don't understand also that what? That you have full of the word. That you have in excess to give. Colossians 3:16 says, let the word of God dwell in you richly. He's talking about in conversation, not that you are just bringing the word inside you, that you recognize that word and you carry it with jealousy and you share it with others. Hallelujah. Recognize that resources or those resources on your inside. Say, I have the living God on my inside. Somebody put your hand on your belly. Put your hand on your belly. Say, the fountain of life is in Jesus. Say, the Holy Spirit of Christ is in me. So when we sing, out of my belly shall flow rivers of living water, you understand exactly now. That is why we have an endless source that we can share with others. So, you know, when I tell you things like, or pastor tells you things like, he can continue teaching you for hours and all of that, you're like, is he just trying to show us that he knows? No. It's because you, not only him, we all have that more to share. Hallelujah. We do what? We have that much to share. You have that much. You are not small at all. You are not small. Stop believing all this understanding of your babe in Christ and all of that. You need to grow. Yes, we all keep growing. But right where you are, you just got saved today. You have the whole of God on your inside. You are not receiving the whole of God tomorrow. He said you were born. You were born. It was the material, the resources used to form, mold you. You were born with the word. Hallelujah. It's not something you're trying to get into. And if you now have the word, I want to enter into the ending of this session now. If you now have the word, use the word. Do what? Use the word. Don't be a silent believer. Don't be what? A silent believer. So you may start your Christian journey. You might start a work of faith without resources. That is not the design of God for you. Hallelujah. It's the work of God. Will God look at his work and say, this work, I will not supply for the work? Think about it. How do you now think or assume that God will want lack for you? How will you think or assume that God will not provide people around you? How would you think and assume that? Use the word. Tell your neighbor one more time. Say, use the word. Use the word. Be a talking believer. It is working for me. I have a river of light on my inside. Oh, the life of God is in me. Everything I touch is full of life. I'm full of power. I pray for the sick, they recover. I pray for the unsaved, they believe and they are saved. I preach the gospel everywhere I go. As one man, I take massive projects, not requiring aid or support. I'm full of all of God. I have the tangible blessings of the Lord. Oh, I minister the truth to the saints. I pick the full gospel and I share with the people. I carry the power of God on my inside. I speak as one with exousia, one giving delegated authority. I have received the inheritance of the Son, and I communicate to the same to everyone in the name of Jesus. You pick scriptures like this and you keep meditating it, meditating on it. You keep regurgitating on it. You keep ministering to yourself. I'm the blessed of the Lord. My hands are not weak. If the Lord could teach the hand of David to walk, the Lord will teach my mouth to speak. If the Lord could teach the hand of David to walk, the Lord will teach my hand to think good thoughts, to bring forth ideas. Oh, the wisdom of God is at work on my inside. I'm honored everywhere I find myself. I carry the presence of God. I am greatly anointed. I'm richly anointed. I am blessed everywhere I am going. Hallelujah. Glory to God. There is no sickness in my body. There's no reason I'm not coming to church because I'm sick. I'm not going to stay at home and be lying down and say, Pastor, sorry, I cannot come, I'm sick. No. You know the amazing thing about believers is that they rather want money to cure their sickness than believe in God's supernatural power to heal their body. A believer. So what do you exactly believe in? That God really lives inside you? How will God live inside you and sickness is living with you also? Right here where you are sitting and there is a sickness on your body, you can jump up right now and say, that sickness, sit down there. It's the authority that you have. That is the power. That is the authority that God has given you. Now the creator of the whole earth has given his all to you. Sickness is not my portion. Sickness will not hinder me from serving God. Money will not hinder me from serving God. Nothing will hinder me from serving God. You know, Mama was mentioning earlier about the school, academics, elective, core courses. Imagine if you get A's in all your electives and you pack. You pack in the core ones. What will happen? That is the same thing that God tells us about the man whose soul is not given to the gospel. It's a waste. Sorry to say. It's a waste. It's a waste. As I serve God, people serve me. As I'm committed to God, resources are committed to me. This faith is working on my inside. This faith is working. This faith is working. I'm never stranded. I'm never broken. You see, all of these scriptures, you bring them, you put them in front of you, and you begin to hit them. You begin to hit them. Surely, God's goodness and mercy shall follow us. God, surely. That he that created the heavens and the earth has supplied all things for you according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. If you say you have received an inheritance like Jesus has received, this is an idea. Jesus never at any point in time accumulated wealth of such, but he never lacked a thing. Jesus wanted to ride in the best of cars in his days. He said, go into that city. I'm going to bring that Bugatti. Go into that city. I'm going to bring that private jet. That is what I want today. He was not accumulating any wealth, but he had that much authority. That is the endless source that we are talking about. You are not taking from trinkles, but in large sum. In what? Large sum. Not trinkles again. Not just a monthly salary. Not just when people have their time and just think about it. No. You have endless resources. Endless. The power of God is supplying all things for me. Aya pakata la barata la bash. Enna makate le barata. Oh, I receive of the endless inheritance of Christ Jesus. You know what Isaac said to Esau? He said, I have sustained your brother. I have sustained your brother. He has not given him anything, but I have sustained him. With the words of his mouth, I have sustained him. He can never be poor again. Let him run anyhow he likes. Let him do anything he likes. He can never be poor again. I have sustained him. Do you believe so much in God's power
in God's word to sustain you, to keep your mind sane. It's not a suggestion. I'm not giving you suggestions this morning. It's the truth. It's the truth. You have to believe it as it is. So somebody is disturbing you. I'm going to preach the gospel to that person disturbing me, and I'm going to get them saved. Is that boss? That boss will not let you go for your conference. Okay. 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 This is the inheritance that we have received. We are not beggarly people. We are not beggars. Oh, please, I want to do something. No. We are not beggars. We have the inheritance of God on our inside. All of God is on our inside. We are not small. He has given us authority over principalities and powers. When we enter a city, we take it over. He has given us the keys to the cities. That is the grace that we have received. He has strengthened our hands. That when we lay our hands on the sick, they recover. We are not suggesting if they will recover or may not. No. We are strengthened. We are strengthened. There is power. There is virtue surging out of our eternal life. It's the power of God. It's the entirety of God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Rise on your feet this morning. Begin to take declarations this morning. Your tongues are declarations. Declarations to God, to angels, and to men by the Spirit of God. That you are compelling men to you. Resources are coming from all over. Oh, I'm flying on eagle's wing. The horn of my inheritance is lifted. Hallelujah. Time will not just permit. I would have shown you from Ephesians chapter 5 how this preservation of God was typified by what is called marriage, or the system marriage. He said he presents you with the washing of the waters with the word of God. In other words, he's the one who supplies that word. So when you just feel like scripture just keeps coming to you, you know. Over the week, I've just been hearing over and over again, I'm special and special. And I was with my dad on Friday. And I don't know, he probably does not even know he was speaking by the Spirit. Just saying, you're just a special boy. God supplies the word. God himself, he has a plan for you. He said, the thought that I have of you. My. You can never be small. Rana Matel Ebahalish. In that Romans chapter 8, he was talking about the endless expectation of me. I'm going to shake the world. I'm a world shaker. Rakatele Bahande Bele Karabaya Talamanas. In John chapter 4, in John chapter 15, it shows us how to glorify God. Rana Mate Kabalanemesh. Is somebody decreeing this morning? Somebody decree this morning, I have an inheritance of God. The resources in heaven have been provided unto me abundantly. I take all these resources in the name of Jesus. I take from within and put upon. This is the victory that overcomes the world. Even my faith. I have received a new life. I take all this newness of life. The life, that mind that was in Christ Jesus is in me right now. Oh, I receive all resources. Glory to God, I receive all resources. From the south, from the west, from the east, and from the north, they are coming to me in abundance.
We trust you had a good time with God's Word. To enjoy more of this, follow us on our Twitter and Instagram handles @_treasurechurch and on YouTube @treasurehousechristwaychurch. God bless you.